morning, fellas, and welcome back to Me Plays Games, the show that, contrary to popular belief, does indeed have three members. My name is Matt, and today, Elias, Dash, and I are going to take you through the Pokemon Crystal speedrun.
What's up, guys? I'm Dash, and my hidden power is fighting type.
And I'm Elias, and my me looks absolutely nothing like me. Thanks for nothing, Matt.
Don't mention it. Today, we'll be talking about the route and techniques the world record uses.
The record for this game belongs to WaveWarrior, the time of 3 hours, 8 minutes, and 10 seconds. If you watched Matt's video about the red and blue speedrun, you'll notice that the record is quite a bit longer, and that's because the speedrun's rules are that it ends when you beat the secret final boss Red, instead of the Pokemon League champion Lance. This adds the entirety of the Kanto region to the end of the run, where you have to do 8 more gym battles before fighting him.
Be sure to subscribe to Me Plays Games for more speedrun-related content, and join our Discord server. You'll find the link to that in the description.
This is actually the first video all three of us are doing together, so I'm excited to jump into it. Alright, let's get started. The run starts with the first of several RNG manipulations we'll be taking a look at. This one is called Lottery ID Manip, or LID Manip for short. In Goldenrod City, there's a lottery show where you win a prize if the digits of the number they announce match the IDs of any of your Pokemon. You know you got the manip right if your trainer ID is 26821. You do this manip by resetting the game, doing specific inputs, then going into the game to check your ID. You also wait about 50 seconds before you start in order to ensure other manips work later on. LID Manip makes it so that you win the lucky number show later on, which is really important for this route. Note that this setup doesn't count towards the runtime. Keep in mind that the RNG is set when you hit new game, and everything after that is just checking that you did it right.
There are a ton of factors that need to be the same every time you do the run in order for all of the RNG manips to work. You need to set the time to 10:01 AM, pick the girl Chris as your player character, and change the border around the text boxes to frame type 6. The other settings are standard for Pokemon speedruns. Fast text speed, set battle mode so the game won't ask you if you want to switch Pokemon, and battle animations off.
One more thing to note is that for whatever reason, Chris's sprite has less lag in battle than the male character, Ethan's, so that saves a little time too. One frame per battle. Anyway, next up, runners will do Totodile Manipulation, or Totomanip for short.
Toto, I have a feeling we're not in Kansas anymore.
Anymore? We're all from New York.
Actually, I was born in New York, then sent back in time after reading the time code.
Neat.
That's a Futurama reference.
Wow!
Totomanip allows you to get a Totodile with perfect determinate values, or DVs for short, which will give it the best stats possible. While you're in the professor's lab, press up, then down, save the game within a specific window, and reset the game again. By re-entering the game within the 2-frame window, you'll get the Totodile you need to get through the early game. In order to time these manipulations properly, runners will use a metronome-based timer, like Flow Timer.
So Totodile is the best starter for a handful of reasons. For one, it learns Rage, an incredible move in the early game. Every time you take damage, the move gets stronger. Cyndaquil gets Smokescreen instead, which just lowers its opponent's accuracy. Not ideal for a speedrun. Chikorita, don't even bother. It has a type disadvantage against both of the first two gyms.
I'll bother with it after the video. I'm gonna make myself a nice salad. Grass-type Pokemon are made of plant, not meat, right?
I was not prepared for this question.
All of the RNG manipulations also depend on the number of steps you take, so you have to plan out your movement carefully for this run. Speaking of which, let's talk about the Route 29 manip. This time, you're saving and resetting, then re-entering the game within a 4-frame window, then doing some specific movement so you don't get any encounters for the rest of the route, as well as Route 30.
That takes us to rival Wunvel. Chikorita has Growl, and while it doesn't miss in the world record, it's worth noting that in Gens 1 and 2, status moves have a built-in 25% chance to fail if an AI Pokemon is using them. So even if Chikorita does use Growl, it can still miss despite having a 100% accuracy when humans use it.
Drop off the egg you got from Mr. Pokemon's house at Elm's Lab, then do Route 29 Manip again, calling your mom along the way so she doesn't call later. After that, you do Route 30 and 3/4 Manip, so that you don't get any encounters on the way to Violet City. Now it's time for Faulkner's Gym, where you build up Rage to breeze through the fight. Afterwards, runners will head to the Pokemon Center, pick up the egg from the scientist there, heal to restore Rage's power points, then head off to Route 32. Once again, runners will do a manipulation here to make sure they don't get any encounters. It also allows you to pick up a Repel and dodge a Spinner.
Guess we should talk about spinners now, and no, not the kind you play board games with.
I'm sure they'd be willing to play Scrabble if you asked them.
First of all, you know what I mean. Second of all, what the heck kind of Scrabble are you playing?
Third of all, shut up.
Anyway, spinners are trainers who spin around semi-randomly in the overworld, and you have to battle them if they see you. In speedruns, they're kind of the worst thing in the universe, because you waste 30 seconds at the very least if you wind up battling one of them, and usually it's longer. You'll see runners pause the game to react to spinners' movement every once in a while, and there are a couple of other ways to deal with them that we'll see soon. You have to pass spinners around 30 times over the course of the run, so have fun with that. Aside from that, there are also rotators who spin in a predictable pattern.
Remember when Dash said we'd see other ways to deal with spinners soon? Yeah, by that we mean right now. By using repels on very specific tiles, they'll run out right before spinners. This will give runners a small buffer to see what the spinner is doing and react accordingly. Alright, with that being said, welcome to Azalea Town. Talk to Kurt and help him out in Slowpoke well. Then it's time to tackle Bugsy's gym.
In this fight, we see the first use of the battle items, also known as X items. They raise your stats by one stage in battle. Set up an X attack on Bugsy's Metapod, and then build Rage all the way through Scyther, whose name has approximately too many consonants in a row.
Pretty sure the Y in Scyther is being used as a vowel.
Matt, I say this with nothing but love and respect, and maybe a hint of amnesia, but I don't think anybody asked. Wait, you just recycled that joke from the MKWii video. Ugh, whatever.
Hi everyone, I'm Matt, the guy who does most of the writing and editing for these videos. Please do not yell at Dash and Elias for the dumb jokes. Yell at me 3 times instead. After the Bugsy fight, Totodile will hit level 18 and evolve into Croconaw. This is important because the next rival fight is basically impossible as Totodile. Croconaw has better defenses and also learns the bug-type move Fury Cutter upon evolving. It starts at 10 base power, then doubles each time you use it in a row. This is the only way to deal super effective damage to the rival's Bayleaf right now on the run.
Unfortunately, rival Tuval and the upcoming gym battle with Whitney are the two worst fights in the game. That's thanks in part to them being the only two major fights where we use Fury Cutter, the only move with less than 100% accuracy we use in the whole run. Once the rival fight is done though, it's off to Goldenrod City.
First order of business is we need to buy a bike. Then, head north of town to pick up Kenya the Spiro. The guy asks you to bring Kenya to his friend to deliver some mail, but we can also just not do that. And we won't. Remember the lottery ID minute from earlier? The ID you get from that matches Kenya's ID, which means you're guaranteed to win the lottery game in just a few minutes. Also, fun fact, you can use Cut to get rid of grass tiles in Gens 1 through 3. This is used in the speedrun because it can eliminate the possibility of encounters. After you talk to Floria further north of town, head back to deposit the egg in the PC. If you get a good run, you can eat it for breakfast in the morning.
I'm allergic to Togepi, so I'll pass.
Next up is Whitney, one more fight in which you have to use Fury Cutter. This fight can be an absolute disaster because she leads off of a Clefairy that knows Metronome.
Hey man, I wonder if using a Pokemon with the move Metronome can help you practice music. Maybe your rhythm would suck less if Clefairy helped you out.
Okay, wow, I'm calling whatever authorities won't hang up on me instantly.
Jeez, why do you script these?
Writing your own roasts is in style these days, don't you know?
As you can probably imagine, a move that can call any other move at random can be an absolute train wreck in speedruns. You can be forced to switch to Spiro, get paralyzed, die to a super effective electric move. Isn't it great? But if all goes well, you can build up Fury Cutters and two-shot Miltank. Maybe even one-shot it if you get a crit. Now it's time for a shopping spree.
Hello and welcome to the Goldenrod Department Store, the only store in the Johto region with the words Goldenrod and Department in the name, or your money back, guaranteed! This shopping covers most of the runner's needs for the rest of the game. After selling your TMs, you buy a bunch of escape ropes to get out of caves and stuff quickly, as well as a mountain of X specials. These raise your special attack by one stage in battle, which is going to come in handy in a bunch of places later on.
Once that's done, head over to the radio tower to play the Lucky Number Show. Wow, that sounds like a cheap knockoff Deal or No Deal. Thanks to the minute from earlier, you win a Master Ball, which we'll be using shortly. But first, we have to fight Rival 3. For this fight, runners will send Kenya out as a meat shield and wait for his Haunter to use Curse. That way, you can bring in Croconaw safely to set up 5 X specials. That way, you have a chance to two-shot Bayleaf with Bite. WaveWarrior also manipulates the AI in this fight too. Prior to the battle, you intentionally get Rage to 6 or fewer power points, then use it on Haunter, which won't affect it. But it'll effectively lock him into using Spite, a non-damaging move that just takes away from power points from the move you just used last. That allows you to set up your X specialist safely.
Once the fight is over, you meet the 3 legendary beasts, and thanks to Lottery ID Manip, you can actually catch one of them right away. By doing Raikou Manip, you can get a Raikou on the route south of town with very specific DVs. It's manipulated so that its hidden power will be Ice-type, which is important for a bunch of fights later on. Raikou is level 40, compared to Croconaw, who is only level 22 by this point. You're basically bringing a knife to a pillow fight. The game gets really easy for quite a long time because you're such a high level.
Usually, you wouldn't want to put HMs on a legendary, but runners will actually teach Raikou strength. That's mostly because Raikou's level up moveset is pretty limited, and most of the other TMs it can learn like Thunder aren't in convenient places. Power points are also tight, so you need whatever attacking moves you can get. So once Raikou hits level 41, you're basically rocking with Quick Attack, Thunder Shock, Strength, and Spark for a while, till you'll learn Hidden Power and Crunch later. And now that we have a Legendary, we can throw Croconaw in the trash. Or at least we would if it couldn't learn HMs we need to beat the game.
What follows is a whole lot of nothing. This game gets incredibly easy for a while, which runners describe as a blessing and a curse. There isn't a whole lot that can go wrong here, but it's very difficult to gain time over previous runs. Other than spinners, the run is basically free from here up on out until the last member of the Elite Four. After destroying Morty and Chuck, the next order of business is the Team Rocket hideout. Most of the grunts here are underleveled, even compared to the other trainers in this part of the game. Since you have a level 40-something legendary, you don't have a whole lot to worry about. Runners actually aim to do neutral damage wherever they can in this part of the game. If a move is super effective or not very effective, that'll trigger an extra text box, which slows things down. And since you're so much stronger than everything you're fighting, neutral damage is usually enough for one shot.
Before fighting the Ice-type gym leader Price, teach Raikou Hidden Power. Pillow Swine is immune to electric moves, so Hidden Power will allow you to do neutral damage with Raikou's higher special attack.
Hey, Dash, since we're onto the ice gym, I figured I'd mention this. Remember the Mario Kart Wii video we did together?
You know what would be great, Matt? If you opened a comedy club in Antarctica so no one would ever have to hear your jokes again.
Works for me. I'll have you know the penguins love me. Yeah, I went ahead and did it.
Oh, nice.
Polar Bear broke in and destroyed it within a week.
Wait, aren't polar bears from the Arctic?
He was visiting his penguin pen pal.
Does that happen?
Oh no, I guess so. Do I look like an animalologist to you? Don't answer that.
Anyway, Price's other Pokemon are water types, so they're weak to spark.
Huh, I guess the Price was right.
Number one, this is like the stupidest Photoshop job you've ever done. Number two, oh my god, we are not doing puns right now. Number C, really? Two game show references in one video?
Numero cuatro, he lost, so wouldn't the Price be wrong?
I hate you guys.
Next up is Jasmine's gym. In the off chance you were curious, the second best hidden power for this run would be fire type. It would allow you to hit Price's Piloswine, as well as all of Jasmine's Steel-type Pokemon and your rival's Meganium for super effective damage. But you wouldn't have a good move for Lance's 3 Dragonite in the champion fight, so it's best to accept that her Magnemite will resist all your moves. Unfortunately, she's got some really problematic moves, namely Thunder Wave and Supersonic. And there's also about a 5% chance the Magnemite don't get one shot.
Next up, another half hour of nothing. After the Steel Gym is Team Rocket's takeover of the Radio Tower. In this part of the story, there's over 20 fights in a row where you one-shot literally every single Pokemon, although a few can survive with a really bad damage roll. The Rival 4 battle is also here. The Rival 4 battle is now over. Power points are extremely tight, especially in this part of the game. By the time you finish the Radio Tower, you'll be almost completely out of moves.
While this part of the run plays, Matt scripted me to kick off a little game of Two Truths and a Lie with you guys. I'll start, and then you guys can have fun with each other in the comments. My name rhymes with Flash, I'm less than 2 miles tall, and I won a sweepstakes when I was 8, and ever since then, I've gotten a pair of ice skates in the mail every week, and 2 on my birthday. If you can guess the lie, then you get absolutely no prize. Let's have a toast to Matt for his creativity right there.
In Ice Path, we see a kind of weird mechanic. When you enter a cave, you get 4 steps of immunity from wild Pokemon encounters. So what runners will do here is take 4 steps into the cave, then use a repel. This will also make it so that it runs out right before the ladder to the next floor down. While you're in here, you also get the Waterfall HM. For whatever reason, Croconaw can't learn it till Gen 3. Oh well, just means we'll have to teach a Dratini we get from the Dragon's Den instead.
Speaking of dragons, let's do the Dragon Gym, shall we? Hidden Power is a one-shot on all 3 of Claire's Dragonair, but Kingdra is a 2-shot. Runners will use Strength and Spark in that order to make sure Claire doesn't heal. Grab the badge Andratini from the Dragon's Den and it's on to Kanto for the Pokemon League. Did you know that it's called the Kanto region because you can totally become the champion?
Matt, go away. Dash and I will handle the Elite Four.
Yeah, alright, see you guys in a few.
The next 4 fights are basically preparation for the last member of the Elite Four, Karen. And we'll explain what that means in a second. First, you take care of your rival on Victory Road.
Then you one-shot Will's entire team. The end. Then you one-shot Will's entire team. This fight isn't too important. Second is Koga. Ariados has Double Team and Baton Pass, which could be annoying since it could pass the evasion boost to another Pokemon, but after that, you won't have too many problems.
During the Bruno fight, you need to set up 2 X-Specialists to sweep his team. You'll actually end up taking damage from Hitmontop's Dig, as well as Hitmonchan's Mach Punch later on. In the world record, we see WaveWarrior intentionally get hit by a Hitmonlee High Jump Kick as well. This is going to be important once we get to Karen.
Speaking of which, here she is. During the previous 4 fights, the goal was to find some way to take enough damage to get below half health, which manipulates Karen's AI. Her Umbreon favors the move Feint Attack and Sand Attack. If you're above half health, she'll usually use Sand Attack, but below half, she'll usually use Feint Attack. We want Feint Attack because it barely does any damage to Raikou, so if you get it 3 times in a row while you set up to sweep her team, you'll have a 100% accuracy on your moves and you're pretty much home free.
Heal up for the champion fight against Lance and move on. This fight is basically free. Gyarados, Aerodactyl, and Charizard are all weak to Spark, and his 3 Dragonite are weak to Hidden Power Ice, so you can actually one-shot his entire team without any setup. Actually, come to think of it, when I said this fight is free, I meant that in a literal sense too. I don't think you technically need to spend a single dollar in-game to become the Pokemon champion.
Actually, I'm pretty sure the currency is based on yen.
Nice.
Hey fellas, I'm back. By this point, you're in the Hall of Fame, but the run isn't over yet. Remember that we have to play the entirety of Kanto. It ain't over till the Fat Lady beatboxes and she signed up to see 16 gym battles. The Kanto region is mostly about execution. There's not a lot of RNG here. You have to pass spinners 8 more times, but that's more or less it. You can fight the 8 Kanto gyms in any order that you'd like, and after a ton of work, speedrunners have come to the conclusion that the optimal order is Misty, Surge, Blaine, Janine, Erica, Blue, Sabrina, Brock. Not gonna lie, I never realized you didn't have to fight Blue last. I've never played that far into a Johto game. Anyway, we save Sabrina and Brock for last so that Raikou hits level 61 and learns the Dark-type move Crunch before we fight them.
That takes you to Mount Silver, and on the way up, you go through a dark cave. Normally, you're meant to use Flash to light it up, but that's slow and bad, so you just bike through it blindly. Well, almost blindly. Runners will use the item balls as cues to get through. Either way, do not try this at home.
Elias, most people don't have caves in their homes. They couldn't try this at home if they wanted to.
Says you, I had a professional caveologist convert my closet into a cave. Half my clothes are hanging from stalactites. Hey Matt, have you ever considered writing jokes that are actually funny?
Nope.
Anyway, it's time for the secret final boss, Red. Since we're using an electric type, it's fairly safe to set up against Pikachu, who will only use Charm, which lowers attack, a stat that you're not using, and Thunder, which you resist. You need 6 X specials to beat Red though, since Snorlax is really bulky and he'll use Amnesia to double his special defense when he gets the chance. If he didn't exist, you'd be able to get away with 4 X specials, which is still a lot, but you're underleveled for this fight, so what can you do?
Welp, there it is, fellas. That's how Pokemon Crystal can be beaten in under 3 hours and 10 minutes. As a little bonus for everybody who made it to the end of this video, here's a conversation I had with Dash over text while I was revising the script. Yeah, a lot of the top runners have been absolutely awesome. WaveWarrior even gave me feedback on a couple of the jokes.
We're gonna need that.
Wow. I mean, you're not wrong.
I had to. Share the screenshot on the video.
You got it. Just FYI, your name in my phone is Dirtbag. Complimentary.
Lovey. I mean lovely.
Oh man. My friends and I are functional human beings, don't worry. Be sure to subscribe to the channel for more videos like this, and leave a comment letting us know what else you'd like to see from us. I also do videos about speed solving the Rubik's Cube, so next time on the show, we'll be taking a look at the history of the one-handed world records. We'll see you all in the next one. Good night, fellas, sleep well.